Welcome to Oilers TV Playoffs presented by Sport Chek. Game 5 tonight as we bring in NHL on Rogers analyst Louie DeBrusk. Louie, always good to chat with you. Welcome to the program.
Tom, great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Right, excellent. We were in San Jose the other night. It was a shellacking, to say the least, on the part of the Oilers from the Sharks. Tonight, what do you expect from Edmonton going into Game 5? Because that was the worst defeat in Oilers history in terms of margin of victory.
I expect a real pushback. And I think if you look over the course of this year, Tom, from the Oilers' perspective, they've only had a couple of games where they felt that they really got outmanned the way they did against San Jose in Game 4. So if you look at that, when they came back after into the next game, they always had a bounce-back game. And that's been one of the greatest attributes of this young team, I think, this year, is the fact they can kind of shrug off those bad losses, get back to the drawing board, and get back to doing what they do best. And that's, you know, managing the puck a little bit better and being a physical team to play against. I think they got away from that in Game 5 early on, and they never were really able to get back on track, and it showed in the scoreboard.
Did anyone see that result coming?
You know what, it's funny because we kind of talked a little bit about the fact that there might have been a team that really took off out of the gates. And San Jose, as everybody knows, has been an amazing starting team all year long and throughout their history. And especially this year, they've been a great front-running team. But I don't think anybody saw a 7-0 game. I think, you know, a 3-4-0 game or a 4-1 game. But with how tight this series has been, that was certainly a shellacking. That was certainly a statement by San Jose. And it was the big players for San Jose that got it done. And Edmonton's going to have to respond.
Louie, in your experiences as a player, when a game like that happens and you're on the receiving end, how does a team go about trying to come back the next game strong, especially in the postseason?
You know, the greatest thing about the playoffs is the fact that it is a series. And you heard the statements after the game from the Oilers and, you know, Connor McDavid, it's 2-2. And he's right. You know what? He's exactly right. That's the way you have to approach the game, is the fact that every game is a separate entity and it's just another game in the series. You have to win 4 to win the series, and right now it's 2-2. They have home ice advantage in the best of 3. Those are the positive things that are coming out of the dressing room in Edmonton, and you really do have to try and have a short term memory about a loss like that. You have to scrap it. You have to get back to the drawing board, and you have to do the things that you know you've done well this year. I have no doubt that they're going to come out and be a much better team in game number 5, because they have to be.
And they have to also be much better in the discipline department. The Sharks made them pay, going 4-for-8 the other night in San Jose. The Oilers, 22 penalties thus far through 4 games. What's going on with them? Because that's not the team that they were during the regular season.
I think you have to give a little bit of the credit to San Jose. I think they're a team that, you know, the way they play, because they're so aggressive on the puck and they pressure you so hard that, you know, you're prone to taking those stick infractions. But at the same time, after taking 12 through games 1 and 2 in Edmonton, they dialed it in with only 2 penalties taken in game number 3 in San Jose, but then they come out and take 8 in game number 4. Now, albeit, some of those penalties were taken after the fact. That game was already pretty much done, and there's a little bit of undisciplined play that goes there. But for me, the concern was the early penalties when the game was still in the balance, when it was only a 2-0 lead where you could still potentially get back into it. So it's been a theme throughout the whole series. They have to be more disciplined, and they keep saying the right things, but now it's time to go out there on the ice and do it. And I do believe that they finally learned their lesson with that 7-0 defeat.
All right, Lou, let's head to the Oilers locker room, hear what they have to say.
This is a stupid play. That's not who I am. That's not me. It's not how I want to be seen as a player. And I think everyone knows that I'm the last guy that wants to hurt anyone out there, or that wants to play that type of games. I have to be better. I have to make sure that you know, I'm a force out there, and I have to get back to playing my game. And tonight is a good start for that.
We talked about it after game 1, shift length and penalty minutes. And we haven't still caught on to the message of the penalties. I mean, obviously that group over there, power play, has been together for 7-8 years. So, I mean, eventually they were going to get hot, and they just got hot all together.
You know, I can review that whole game, but I'm wasting my time. When we're playing well, we play quite evenly with them in those areas. So 7-0, you know, take you through the whole game if you want, but you don't want to stay here that long.
So there you have it, the Oilers saying the right things, as Louie mentioned before. Now it's a point of putting it into action. Leon Draisaitl, we have to hit on this. The discipline thing we've talked about, the spearing penalty he took on Chris Tierney. What do you make of that, Lou?
as he said, it uncharacteristic of Leon Draisaitl, although he does play with that edge and he has been physical in this series. But again, I think it goes back to the frustration that San Jose is bringing out in the young Oilers team because of the lack of offense. But for Leon, as he said, get back to doing what he does best and be more assertive on the scoreboard instead of physically.
Okay, so we have to take a look at the lineups as well, because Todd McLellan tweaking some things up front. Drake Caggiula finds himself on the left wing on the top line with Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl. Patrick Maroon on the proverbial third line alongside Mark Letestu and Zach Cassian. What do you make of these moves, Lou?
Well, we've seen it before, and you know what? There's no doubt that I think they tried the experiment of putting Leon back at center and seeing how that would work, but he's better on that right side right now with Connor McDavid. That tandem was the highest scoring tandem in the National Hockey League for a reason. They have chemistry. Drake Caggiula, interestingly, going up to the top line, it does a couple of things. There's definitely more speed there with Caggiula than Maroon, and he thinks the game a little bit differently. He's a more of a cerebral player that knows how to jump into the right spots at the right time. He's shown already that playing with those two players, he can read them, he can play with them. They're trying to manufacture some offense here. They're trying to spark something. Listen, the San Jose Sharks did it. They shuffled all four lines for game four, and it paid off with 11 points from their top five players. The Oilers are looking for the same response.
Todd McLellan saying Drake Caggiula, high hockey IQ and tenacious. Let's hear from number 36 in orange and blue.
I know I've been fortunate to play with Connor a few times this season, play with him a little bit on the penalty kill. So I think we've built a little bit of chemistry there. And you know, I'm not going to change my game. I'm just going to make sure I still do my thing. And you know, that's what they want me to do. They want me to play my game, play with that intensity and speed. And I know hopefully it works out for us.
So there you have it. Drake Caggiula finds himself in the spotlight on the left side of the top line. Caggiula, of course, had 7 goals, 11 assists this season. Played a little bit with McDavid during the season. Lou, some final thoughts.
I like the move. You know what? Listen, right now they're trying to, number one, keep San Jose guessing a little bit as well, but also trying to get some confidence built back up in the lineup calling themselves. So I don't mind the move from Todd McLellan. You have to try something, and I expect a much better pushback here from Edmonton. This is the first time their backs have kind of been up against the wall a little bit after a real tough loss in the playoffs. We'll see how they respond.
Connor McDavid, pointless in two games, has never throughout his career been held pointless in three straight. That does it for part one of Oilers TV Playoffs presented by Sport Chek. Lou and I will discuss the Sharks in part two. From inside Rogers Place, it's part two of Oilers TV Playoffs presented by Sport Chek. Tom Gazzola alongside Louie DeBrusk as we head into a pivotal Game 5 matchup here at Rogers Place. Lou, if you're the San Jose Sharks, you got to like everything you did the other night at the Shark Tank. What are they thinking going into Game 5?
Trying to replicate that.
How hard is that to do, though? I mean, it's 7-0.
I know they're not going to come out and be able to necessarily put up 7 on the board and have the free reign they had in game number 4. But what I did like about them was the urgency. And the big guns for San Jose got involved. Their power play started to click. So there was a lot of really good things. But most importantly, they just out-competed the Edmonton Oilers. And that was the word in the dressing room before game 4 from Joe Pavelski, from Joe Thornton, Patrick Marleau, you know, veteran players that said, listen, we can skill all we want, but if we're not going to outwork the opposition, especially with the man advantage, they talked about the penalty killing of the Edmonton Oilers outworking them, they have to get back to winning those battles, and they certainly did with 4 power play goals.
Do you think the Sharks maybe went into that game 4 with a bit of a chip on their shoulder? They dropped 2 straight, and all of a sudden people were talking about, and a lot of people prior to the start of this series were saying, oh, this is the Oilers series to lose here. Do you think those guys, having gone to the Cup Final last year, thought, wait a second, we went to the Cup Final game 6 and lost? And that's part of what they're showing us right now.
I don't think they did. I know they were a little bent out of shape. There was a burr. There was a chip on their shoulder. There was whatever you want to call it. Yeah. They weren't too happy. And obviously being shut out in games 2 and 3, they really weren't happy coming into game 4. And it showed with their response. But these are proud guys that went to the Stanley Cup Final last year, believe they have a strong team, are getting healthier as this series goes along, which is very important, and guys are starting to play the way they can play. This is a dangerous team. They believed it. It hadn't come to fruition yet for them, but we saw a little taste of that for sure in game number 4.
Joe Thornton this morning after the morning skate said that as the games have gone on, I know he's only played in 2, but he says he's feeling better and better. What are you seeing from him, and what has that done to the lineup to have Big Joe back in there?
I was really impressed with the response I saw from the crowd and the team when Joe Thornton came out for game number 3, his first game of the series, and he even admitted that he started to fade late in that game. But game number 4, I saw a different Joe Thornton. I thought he was moving the best I've seen him move, not only in practice but in the 2 games that he's played. He had a little more jump in his stride. He was making plays. His hands were starting to come back. This is a perennial guy that's up there amongst his lead in teams scoring every year that he's played. He's only going to get better as the series goes on, and he had a good game number four.
A lot of guys had great offensive games. On the defensive side of things, what are the Sharks doing right? Because they've held, as we talked to in part one, Connor McDavid pointless in two straight, but the rest of the Oilers as well have been held in check offensively.
Well, we saw it in game number one. After the Oilers got it to a 2-0 lead, one of the things that was really evident to me and why San Jose is such an effective team is their backtracking. And they got back to that in game number four. They were tenacious on the puck, not only offensively on the forecheck, but coming back. So when you have that aggressive back pressure, probably the best that I've seen all year long from any team, very hard for forwards to make plays when you're getting hounded back up the ice. It allows the defenseman to be aggressive, and there's just no time and space on the ice. So that's what makes San Jose so effective. They did that in game number four throughout the whole 60 minutes of the game, and that's why I believe they created the chances they created and drew the penalties they did.
All right, Lou, let's hear from the Sharks this morning after the morning skate.
We don't shelf at you. There's a lot of good things we did that have to stay at that level. You know, breakouts were one of them, just the execution on it, you know, really allowed us to play fast, I think. And, you know, so you just, that commitment has to be there to do it right again.
We played well. Played well in the power play, played well 5-on-5, played well defensively. You know, we'll stick to our game.
I think, yeah, it's nice to see. It was, you know, a big night for a lot of guys last night. And hope to repeat it again tonight.
Well, we broke in pretty good. We seemed to win a few more battles. You know, where at times they were getting it and popping it and getting clears. You know, we won a couple of those. So our desperation level on the power play has to stay up, and we got to keep attacking and shooting that puck and getting it back and all those simple things that made us successful.
It's a long road to get into the playoffs. You know, every team that's here, one of the 16 that's left or 15 now with Calgary out, has dealt with adversity during the year and has obviously responded in the right way during the year in order to give yourself a chance to get, you know, 95 to 110 points to get in. So, you know, we know we're going to get a response tonight, and that's a dangerous thing, and we've got to make sure we're ready for that.
All right, Pete DeBoer and the San Jose Sharks expecting a good response from the Edmonton Oilers after the 7-0 result the other night in San Jose in Game 4. Lou, if you're the Sharks, I mean, how tough is it coming into Game 5 in this building? I mean, the fans in San Jose were tremendous. The fans here have been extremely loud. But if you're the Sharks, how hard is it going to be to get that good, fast start that they're known for?
Well, you know, somebody had a quote out of the San Jose Sharks dressing room that you're not just playing against the team, you're playing against the city when you come to Edmonton. And
that's
it's
fair.
True. It really is true. So I believe that this 10 minutes, the start of Game 5, will be the most important 10 minutes of the series for both sides. You're either going back home to San Jose trying to finish the series, or you're battling for your life. And for Edmonton, it's vice versa. You're going there battling for your life or trying to finish the series off. So I expect a real, real aggressive, hard first 10 minutes, as San Jose has done all series long and season long. But this crowd here at Rogers Place, I believe, weathers that a bit and gives the Oilers that extra man on the ice to try and combat that.
All right, we'll see how the Oilers fare against the Sharks in Game 5. Louie, thank you so much for doing this.
My pleasure, bud.
All right, part three coming up with Oilers alumni Fernando Pisani and Raffi Torres. Oilers TV Playoffs presented by Sport Chek continues with Oilers alumni Raffi Torres and Fernando Pisani, a couple of the heroes from the 06 run. Fernando, always good to see you. And Raffi, welcome to Oilers TV.
Thanks a lot.
All right. Last time we were here, no pressure for you, Raffi, but Fernando, Georges Laroque serenaded you with a little bit of ABBA. I take it you're not going to do the same today, Raffi.
I don't think I am, but is he talking about the song after Fernando would score all the time?
That's the one,
something
yeah.
In the air, Fernando.
Yes. We did it.
I believe it. Every time I think of Fernando, that song pops up.
See, yeah. That's perfect. Yeah. Perfect way to start this segment. Raffi, for you, I know Fernando's around town. He's an Edmonton boy. For you coming back, what's it been like so far? I know the trip's been brief, but what's it like coming back to oil country?
It's been great. It's nice to see a lot of old faces. Got a chance to meet, you know, with Kevin Lowe and Dave Semenko today, and we just, you know, shot the breeze a little bit, and obviously Barry Stafford, and it's just been great, you know, to come back and see some old faces, and, you know, obviously see around the town where I used to run around with my head cut off a couple times, so it's nice to be back.
Fernando, what have you made of this atmosphere around the city this time around thus far, being the Edmonton guy here?
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun. It's funny watching now from a fan perspective, as when Raff and I were playing, it was a different perspective we saw. We tried to shelter ourselves from the outside world, so to speak, and now that we kind of can see it, and it's been a lot of fun and seeing how crazy and excited and how pumped everyone is to watch playoff hockey again.
Raffi, what's it like watching the Oilers in the postseason again since the last time was 06 and you were part of that team?
You know what, it brings back a lot of great memories. You know, I just remember the crowds, and we got a chance to go to the pep rally today. Amazing. You know, these fans they're electric. They love the game. You know, they've gone through some tough years here. So, you know, for me, it's nice to be back at a time like this, where the fans are involved and they're ready to go. And, you know, hopefully we can get a good game tonight.
What do you remember from that run, specifically, when you look back and reflect? I know Fernando mentioned, because we've had him on a few times, having an oil derrick put on his front lawn during that postseason. Did you have anything crazy happen like that? Or do you remember any stories from 06?
You know what? I remember after beating Detroit, White Ave just shutting down, and it was just turned into a big party. And you know, they shut down the streets, and people having a great time. And at that point, I think we went by there after, just for, you know, to celebrate the win. And you know, next thing you know, like high five. I was high fiving people till like 3 a.m. And you know, talking about people. Everyone's giving us tips on the power play and stuff. It was awesome. You know,
well, there's 500,000 coaches in
this city. Exactly. You know, but you got to respect that. You know, I think like I said, this town has gone through some tough times, and you know, for us to, you know, to be back here at a time like this, I think it's great.
Fernando, what was that team like for you back in 06?
You know what, it was a great team to be a part of, just because the battle that we had to go throughout all year to get into the playoffs. And once we got in, it was kind of like a monkey off our back, so to speak. And we just played very loose, and very, like, there was no pressure on us to go out there and play. And you know, Raffi was instrumental in that playoff run. Mike Pex was really good. Prongs, Jason Smith, like, you go through the list of guys that all played so hard. And the biggest thing is we played for each other, and we didn't want to let each other down. And that's how we approached every single game in that playoff run. And you know, you go in that dressing room, you become very good friends with guys, and you get them close, and you know their families. And the biggest thing for us was just, we didn't want to let each other down, and that's how we played.
Let's look at the second round against San Jose. You guys dropped the first two games and come back and win four straight. Raffi, in your eyes, when did that series change? Because I'll say Ryan Smith and Dwayne Rollison both pointed to the hit you laid on Milan Mihalik, saying that's kind of where the momentum swung in the Oilers' favor. What do you see from that?
I think as a young guy, you know, I was just always trying to bring a lot of energy to each and every game. So I know we were down 1-0 in that series, and things weren't going too well in game two. But I just trying to went out there and just you know, get back and get involved. You know, my dad always said to go out there and get involved, get your nose dirty, and you know, work your hardest. So I went out there, was able to lay a big hit. And we just went from there. I think after that, so you could feel like a tilt in the ice at some point. And then, you know, obviously Horkoff the next night with a big OT winner. It was great.
Your take on the San Jose series, Fernando?
Yeah, you know, we came from a series that was kind of a chess game playing Detroit. And we were kind of sitting back a little bit. And they were a team that was a very good puck possession team. And then we went into San Jose, where they were coming at us and coming at us hard, and they were finishing their checks. It was just a much more of a physical series. And then once, you know, once Raff made that big hit, it kind of settled things down and the whole momentum shifted. And then we came back home and we just started playing like we can. And that's kind of, I think, how everything shifted for us.
Okay, fast forward 11 years. Start with you, Raffi. From what you've seen in this series, what have you noticed about it? Because it's been a back-and-forth battle, essentially.
Yeah, it has. You know what? There's two really good teams going at it right now. Obviously, the Sharks have a lot of, you know, they have they've been around for a while.
Yep.
The experience factor. Yep. You know, they've been here. They know what it takes to win. They got a lot of veteran presence out there, is big time, and they're well coached, you know. But I think with, I've been able to coach with McCullough, been on the coaching side of McClellan too, so with him it's just a matter of you know, just sticking to what he teaches you out there, stick to the game plan, and you know, I think the Oilers should be all right.
You want to make a prediction on tonight, guys? What are we going to see? You don't have to say final score, but what are we going to see tonight in this game?
Well, I think, you know, you're going to see a much better, obviously a much better Oilers team coming out, and I think a more disciplined team, and it's going to be a tough, tight game, and that's what playoff hockey is.
Raffi, what are you looking for?
I think you got to come out and you got to come after San Jose. You know, you can't let them get comfortable. Stay out of the box, I think, will be huge for the Oilers. San Jose's got a dangerous power play. But for the most part, I'm looking for guys like Lucic and Maroon, guys to step up and get involved. You know, I played against Lucic in the Stanley Cup Finals sometimes. This guy is dangerous out there. He's mean. He's got the total package. I got a lot of respect for him as a player. So, you know, we'll see what happens.
Raffi Torres, Fernando Pisani, a pleasure, guys. Enjoy the game tonight.
All right, thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot.
All right, that does it for Oilers TV presented by Sport Chek. Pre-game, I've got you covered. Post-game, live tonight following Sharks and Oilers, Game 5.